The one area of the vowel quadrilateral that we haven't addressed yet is the central part. We'll discuss that area in this movie. The central vowels that we'll deal with first are both best considered mid-central vowels. They're a bit tricky because they're the only two vowels with different symbols that sound essentially the same. They sound like as in but. But why do we have two symbols to represent this sound in English? The answer is stress. English has a very different vowel quality in some unstressed vowels. Many unstressed vowels lose their underlying vowel quality and become produced as mid-central vowels, but only when they're unstressed. Because of this important role that stress plays in vowel quality, we use a separate symbol for unstressed vowels that sound like a. This symbol is called schwa, and it's one of the few IPA symbols that many people outside of phonetics will know. For the purposes of this course, we'll treat these two vowels as mid-central vowels, with the only difference between them being stress. So if the vowel is stressed and it sounds like a, then use the caret symbol, also known as the wedge. If the vowel is unstressed and it sounds like a, then use the schwa symbol. It's that easy, although realistically many people will find that this is anything but easy in reality. It really does take some practice. I'll put one last vowel in here, but it has a bit of a different status than the rest of them. This is the typewriter A vowel, which is more of a low central vowel. It's distinct from script A, which is further back, and from ash, which is further front. In modern American English, we don't use this vowel anymore. It's already gone the way that open O is going. So we don't usually put it onto vowel charts that show the vowel phonemes of English. But I want to introduce it because we do use the symbol in transcription as a part of some diphthongs. When we represent I as in bide or ow as in bowed, we use the typewriter A symbol for the first part of these diphthongs. Also note that we use a lax vowel symbol for the second part of these diphthongs. This can be tricky because many people think that they hear the first part of the diphthong as ah, and the last part of the diphthong as e. The truth is that in most diphthongs, what we produce is something that's moving in the direction of these parts of the vowel space, but we don't really reach either extreme. Our use of vowel symbols that are not at the extremes of the vowel space represents this phonetic reality. So when we transcribe I, we use these two symbols. For ow, we use these two, and for oi, we use these two. So now, with this vowel quadrilateral all filled in, you can see that the chart falls into several segments. We could draw some lines to separate the high from the mid from the low vowels, and they'd be pretty much straight lines. The lines that would separate front from central from back might be a little less straight up and down, but they do the job too. And they could really separate out 9 different sections of the quadrilateral. But often, we don't do this. Many vowel charts will not have lines like these because the vowel space is really continuous. We place these symbols in these places because real productions of each of these vowels fall sort of into a particular area of the quadrilateral. But vowel productions are notoriously variable, and in fact some speakers' versions of some vowels end up sounding more like another speaker's version of a different vowel. There's some degree of relativity to vowel productions, and you'll find that some productions of, say, I might end up sounding a little bit more like E, or a bit more like E, or even a bit more like schwa. Recognizing these subtle variations in vowel quality can be quite important, but equally important is not getting bogged down in details. To a large degree, this is where we get into the difference between broad and narrow transcription. In a broad transcription, we're mostly interested in transcribing the big picture version of what someone says. To a degree, this will mean that we'll want to think about the phonemes that are involved, rather than the details of how these phonemes were altered in the actual production. In a narrow transcription, we're much more interested in getting fine-grained detail about a specific production. If we're doing more of a narrow transcription, then we'll want to attend to more specifics of the sounds as they're actually produced, as opposed to representing the broader categories of phonemes as we know them to exist in English. In this class, we'll focus on broad phonetic transcription. This means that we'll mostly use the phonetic symbols that we've introduced as consonants and vowels of English, with some additional considerations paid to how the speech sound system of English produces known, regular effects on the phonetic realization of American English speakers' productions. We'll develop this idea a bit further in the next video, in which we'll look at another vowel chart to see how some variances in vowels might be represented by a slight variance in the vowel chart itself.